half a dozen, six, seven. Tim, we were there when Tim knocked that building down. You know that building over there, on the parking lot? Yeah, the little bulldozer thing he's got.
Coming and worshiping with us again here this morning as we gather together. And as we begin, I just want to draw your attention to just a couple things. One is that we haven't been doing Sunday school, and I neglected to mention this in the first service, but we don't have Sunday school together, Bible study together, but those are still recorded. We do have a children's Sunday school and an adult class and children's church, and all stuff is still recorded. So participate in those, look on our YouTube or our Facebook, and you can find those and participate in them. And then I also wanted to just kind of note, a couple days ago, it brought to my attention, and so I looked it up, that President Trump made a statement that said churches are essential. And I wanted to just take a moment and just kind of address that. I'm thankful that he said that, and I'm thankful that we have people in our government who think that churches are important. But however, I just want to make sure we understand that we really don't need our government to tell us that we're essential. And there are people all over our world that are doing church right now that are in places where their governments are not telling them that they're essential, where they're under great persecution, and they are still serving. And I wanted to also say thank you to Boyd Avenue Baptist Church, because although we spent several weeks not meeting together, and that was hard, it was hard for me. I don't like preaching to the camera. I'd much rather have this and talk to people. But I want to say thank you that in that time, we didn't quit being the church. We didn't stop and say, okay, since we were told we can't do church, that we just quit doing church. We didn't meet together each week, but we did church, and we were essential over the last 8 weeks, and Boyd Avenue Baptist Church will be essential over the next 8 weeks, and hopefully a whole lot longer than that. So I want to say thank you for that, and just remember that who we are, and that we have the opportunity to be God's hands and feet, and it doesn't make any difference if somebody comes out tomorrow and says that churches are no longer essential. It, what they say doesn't matter. It's who we are. And it's because it's who God says that we are. And so because that's the God we serve, let's do that now. Let's turn our hearts, let's turn our minds, and let's go to Him as we worship together.
Amen. I want to invite all of you to stand and join us in song as we begin today. It is great to see you again. I think we say that week in and week out, hey, good to see you, but boy, this virus situation has made that something where we don't take that for granted anymore. It's great to see each and every one of you. And today, as we look at the scripture that Pastor Ed's going to share, and he's going to teach us through today, in Peter, he says, always be ready to give a defense or a reason for the hope that is in you. And so we're very much focused on that today in the song messages, and pray that we would be rooted in His Word, and that we would be ready and faithful to give a reason, however simple it may be or complex, either way, but to be faithful to share the reason for the hope that you have in you today. Let's sing That's Why We Praise Him.
Came to die, so we'd be reconciled. Came to die. sisters, if someone is caught in sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. But watch yourselves, or you may also be tempted. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. If anyone thinks they are something when they are not, they deceive themselves. Each one should test their own actions. Then they can take pride in themselves alone without comparing themselves to someone else. For each one should carry their own load. Nevertheless, the one who receives instruction in the word should share all good things with their instructor. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers.
Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you today for your goodness to us. Thank you, Lord. We have seen your work, seen your mighty hand move, and we know that all your works are good, Lord. And so, Lord, as we look at what you've done, we desire to follow you, to do what you called us to do, to walk in righteousness, to do good all of our days, Lord, to follow you faithfully. We thank you, Lord, once again for your love. We wouldn't know what real, true, sacrificial love was without you, Lord. So we just thank you, God, for giving us your Son. Lord, we pray today that our praises would reach your ears, that you would hear us, Lord, and know, God, that we're here for you and you alone. Lord, we want to lift up those who are struggling with health issues today, but God, most of all, that you would meet each and every spiritual need this day, that we'd be ready to give a reason for the hope that's in us. That all these things would be for your glory, and for your honor, and for your kingdom. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's continue singing together on the cry of my heart. Our desire is to follow the Lord faithfully, and not just in the moments when it's easy, in the seasons when it's easy, right? We all go through difficult times, sometimes where the path is easy and straight and level, but the goal is that regardless of the circumstances around us, that we will follow him faithfully and for all of the days of our lives.
Follow you. It is a cry of my heart to follow you. It is a cry of my heart to follow all.
that aren't passing the plates today, but there are offering plates up here in the front either side, and plates by either back door. You can drop your offering by. And thank you for continuing to give and continuing to support the ministries as Boyd Avenue does ministry around our community and around our world. And so thank you for being a part of that. And let's pray together. Lord, thank you so much. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to participate in your work, to participate by doing, to participate by praying, and participate by giving. And so, Lord, I pray this morning that you do bless the gift, you bless the giver, and Lord, that we be responsible to be good stewards for what you have given. We ask these things in your name. Amen. And you may be seated.
Thank you.
In this time spot where normally we do the special music song, we oftentimes are moving toward songs where you can go ahead and sing along with us. Sometimes songs that we want to share with you for future singing together as a congregation. And this is one of those days and one of those songs. And so we want you to join in and sing with us on The Reason. It's set in a key where you can sing along with us today. And the message is good in that, again, we just continue to recount all of the things that he's done for us and to clarify why we follow him.
Yes.
we'll go ahead and do children's message. If kids want to come on up, we will do that at this time. If you guys wouldn't mind coming up and sitting out here in front of me, that would be fantastic. How are you guys all doing today?
Good.
So I'm going to ask a couple questions like I always do. And I'm going to start with, you know, girls are going to answer, guys, if you have a favorite too, you can tell me this. But girls, who is your favorite princess? Do you have a favorite princess? You don't have one? Guys, you got a favorite princess? Who? Ariel? Okay, so tell me why. Why do you like Ariel? I have girls, and I should know who these princesses are, but I have no idea. Who's Ariel? She's the mermaid? Okay, I thought that was right. Why do you like her? Any reason? You dislike her? Okay. So, I'll ask a different question. What is the best sport? What's the best sport? Nothing? You're a strange child. I bet you don't believe that because you think hunting is a sport?
No.
Hunting is a sport. Yeah.
Me.
You got a favorite sport?
Me.
What?
The loving princess.
The loving princess. I think we're losing where we're going here. Favorite sport? Soccer. Now, why is soccer the best sport? You don't know? Okay, why is basketball the best sport? It's just fun. Okay, let me ask another one. Let's see. What is the best dessert? What's the best dessert? Popcorn. Okay, that's different. Why popcorn? Because your dad makes it, it's good.
What's the ice cream.
That's a much better answer than the last one. I like ice cream. Give me some knuckles. That's my favorite. Give me some knuckles.
Thank you.
Best dessert. What is it?
Watermelon.
Okay. Why watermelon? Just because you like it?
Pie.
What kind of pie? Strawberry pie. Why is that the best dessert? Just because you like it. Okay. Last one. Brownies. Do you like walnuts in your brownies or no? I do.
My mom makes the best brownies.
Your mom makes the best brownies? She should make me some. Okay. Right. So why are brownies the best dessert? Your dad does? Okay, so I asked you these questions, what was the best of something, and you guys gave me answers, and then when I asked you why, you kind of paused for a moment, and sometimes you got a hard at coming up with something, why? Because I like it. Well, in the Bible, the passage we're going to look at today, Peter says that there's going to be times when we got to tell people why we believe what we believe, why we believe in Jesus. And think about some answers. So if somebody said to you, you know, why do you believe in Jesus? And you just said, because I like him. Is that going to convince anybody? Or because I just think he's the best. And so what Peter says is that we have to come to a point where he calls it a defense. We got to be able to tell people why we believe what we believe. And so it's really important for you guys as you go to Sunday school, and as you go to things like children's church, which isn't going to happen today, but hopefully real soon, as you go to things, you learn about the Bible, and you learn things, not just so that you know them, and so you can put it in your brain and think, man, I really like what we do in church, and I love Jesus, but that so when you have people in your life, you can tell them, well, this is what the Bible says, and this is why I believe what I believe, right? Because this man here had the best answer for ice cream being the best dessert, because ice cream is the great. Now, I'll say this. Ice cream on brownies, that's like a plus. Okay? But just the fact that I like it is not going to convince anybody else. And so we got to be able to do that. Okay, so let's pray and ask God to help us to learn about him and be able to tell other people things that we're learning.
And then I have candy for you and then back to your parents, okay? God, thank you for today. Lord, I thank you so much for these boys and girls that are here. And Lord, my prayer is that as we, all of us, learn about you, as we study our Bible, as we minister, Lord, that you help us to truly be able to tell other people the hope that we have in you and tell them why it is that we serve your English God. We ask this in your name. Amen.
I invite you guys to sing one more song with us before the message today. Praise the King.
There's a reason why the curse of sin is broken. There's a reason why the dark. Why we stand here.
have your Bible, if you could take it and turn to the book of 1 Peter, chapter 3. We'll be continuing our study here this morning through the book of 1 Peter. One of the interesting things about teaching through a book of the Bible like 1 Peter is it takes away the temptations to address current events or things that are going on in the world because you just teach through what's next in the passages that you're teaching on. But today I think there's some real relevance to our world in today's passage. And we look at the idea of believers living and working together for the common good of reaching our world. And so we're going to look at this passage today as Peter gives us instructions. And as we look today, we're going to have a little transition. So the last week's sermon, verses 8 and 9, we finished with those verses last week. Well, this week we're going to start with those verses. So we're going to have a little overlap between these two. But I think it's really important to look at this. The importance of how we treat each other. Look, if we're going to really minister to the world and be an example to the world, then it starts with believers. And it starts not with believers being an example, but it starts with believers truly getting along and being unified together. I am very thankful for our church. I am thankful for Boyd Avenue. I'm thankful that we have a church that has a shared vision and a shared ministry. And I'm thankful that we are a church that's united, and we have a desire to reach into our community and reach into our world, that we realize that it takes us all together to do this. We need the unity, and the world needs to see that, because the world oftentimes sees a church as something different, and they see the church as a group of people who always argue with each other and don't really get along, and they look at the church and they say, well, why do I want to be like the church? And we need to understand the importance of us being together. Now, I'm a big Charlie Brown fan. I like Peanuts cartoons. Growing up, I used to catch all the specials. And I was reading a cartoon one time, and Lucy was walking into the living room, and she sees that Linus has control of TV, and she demands that Linus change the channel. And Linus says, "What makes you think that you can come in here and take over?" And Lucy says, "These five fingers, individually, they're nothing. But when I curl them together into a single unit, they form a weapon that is terrible to behold." Linus says, "Which channel do you want to watch?" And then he looks at his fingers, and he says, "Why can't you guys get organized like that?" See, many times we organize our five fingers. We organize ourselves for sometimes things that are evil. But we need to look at the importance of organizing ourselves for things that are good. And so let's look at 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 17. "To sum up, all of you, be harmonious, sympathetic, brotherly, kind-hearted, and humble in spirit, not returning evil for evil or insult for insult, but giving a blessing instead, for your call for the very purpose that you might inherit a blessing. For the one who desires life, to love and see good days, must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. He must turn away from evil and do good. He must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears attend toward their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Who is there to harm you if you prove zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed. And do not fear their intimidation, and do not be troubled. But sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, always being ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence. And keep a good conscience, so that the things in which you have slandered those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better, if God should will it so, that you should suffer for doing what is right, rather than for doing what is wrong." And so here this morning, we look at the idea of believers, and we as believers need to seek peace whenever possible. We are not to be troublemakers. And our faith community is a community of believers. We are to respond positively. And so Peter here, as we look at this passage, He describes the kind of people that we should work to be in order that we can live right with our brothers and sisters in Christ. And if we live right with our brothers and sisters in Christ, then in return, we'll be an example to the world. See, we have unbelievers, and they're quick to point out all the shortcomings of the church and all the shortcomings of Christians. And what Peter's saying here is we need to live in such a way that we don't let people see those shortcomings, that we don't want that to be what people see. And so he gives these five adjectives that describe what a believer living in community with other believers, what they should look like. And he says that we should be harmonious, which means we should be like-minded, sympathetic, brotherly, which means loving, kind-hearted, and humble. And we've talked about these a little bit last week, but these five terms, they're adjectives, and they describe this is who you should be. These are attitudes of the heart. These are attitudes of character. This is the things that we are deep on the inside. And so let's look at these things again this week as we look at the idea of being like-minded. The church, we as believers, we need to have the same overall values, the same goals, the same intentions. Look, our focus should be on glorifying God in all that we do. It should be the desire of our heart. We should love our neighbors. We should love those that are around us, both believers and unbelievers. We need to love each other. See, we understand as believers that we are like-minded because we have the mind of Christ, and we see who God is. We read about what Jesus says, and we say, if this is what is important to him, if this is the things that are important to God, then we want to make our lives the same as his. And so the things that are important to him become important to us. And if they're important to us, then they're important to us together as we're like-minded. And then sympathetic. He says we need to be so sympathy to each other. We need to be people in a church that observe and feel each other's pain and also experience others' joy. Rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. When people in our congregation go through difficult times, we should be there for each other and come alongside them. And when people in our church are celebrating together, we should have the opportunity to celebrate with them. See, Jesus, he understood our weakness. And he could sympathize with our weakness because he came and he experienced the things that we experienced. He came and he experienced suffering and he experienced death. And he understands what we're going through. And he says that I get it, I understand. And you also need to walk through those things together. Sometimes we need to be people who just simply sit with each other quietly and listen to each other and truly love each other, to care about each other. To be people in our church who look around and we put the needs of others first. Then we look at what's happening in our church, in our world, and we say, you know, maybe there's some things that I have rights to do or some things that make me feel comfortable, but I really love somebody else, and so I'm going to put the needs of somebody else before my own. I'm going to love them. See, as the body of Christ, we're not just traveling in this world together. We're not just like ships in the sea that just pass each other. And then we're kind of waving each other as we go by. And we're not just living independently, but together. See, as a church, as a body of believers, we shouldn't just be people who we spend a little bit of time together on a Sunday morning and this is who we are. But we need to be people who are invested in each other. A family that sticks together through difficult times. A family that sticks together when things are hard. And a family that goes together when things are good. See, then we see a world that will look and they'll say, hey, what's different about them? We talked about this last week, that Jesus says they're going to know you're my disciples by your love. And we need to love each other and seeking each other and kind-hearted, compassion. Maybe people of compassion, tender-hearted, willing to forgive, not holding a grudge, that idea of compassion. And I'm going to be honest, compassion's not the easiest thing for me. I take those spiritual gift tests, and I have no mercy, and I'm not always the most compassionate person, and we talked years ago about doing a counseling center, maybe to church, and we talked about names for it, and my idea was to suck it up and get over yourself counseling center. I struggled in those areas, but we need to be that kind-hearted. Ephesians 4:32 says, be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ also forgave you. Not only kind-hearted, but humble. We need to be humble people, not thinking more highly of ourselves than we ought to.
to consider others more important than ourselves, to trust it that if we're going to do what God has called us to do, we don't need recognition. We don't need everybody else to tell us that we're doing a good job. We can trust that God is going to lift us up, and we're just going to serve and love people because it's what we do. You notice that this compassion, this humbleness, they go together a little bit. See, a compassionate person is a person who forgives. A humble person is a person who doesn't demand to be forgiven. See, a compassionate person will notice and they'll forgive others, but a humble person is just going to serve and do things regardless of what people around them say or do. And this is a description that only comes from somebody who is made new in Christ. Because these aren't things that we do naturally. These aren't things that just come because of who we are. They're not natural to us. This only comes through the power of Christ as we seek Him and His righteousness. And this only comes when we, as believers, choose to come alongside each other and choose to do these things together. Jackie Robinson was the first African-American to play Major League Baseball. And as he played Major League Baseball, they chose him for a reason to play because of his character. But every place he would go, he would suffer jeers and threats and all different kinds of things. And it was very difficult as he did those early days trying to play as the only African-American player. And one particular day, he had a really bad game, and he was not playing well, and things were getting personal to him. And he makes an error at shortstop, and the fans are going crazy, and they're screaming at him. And the second baseman, a guy by the name of Pee Wee Reese, walks over next to Jackie, and he puts his arm around him, and they just stand there for a few moments and just look at things together. And Jackie Robinson says that was the moment that may have saved his career. That he was ready to give up. He was ready to be done. And that was the moment that may have saved it. Because somebody who loved him and cared about him came alongside of him. See, as a church, we need to do that. As a body of believers living in this difficult world, we need to do that. There are times in our world where we have believers, fellow brothers and sisters who are struggling and ready to give up. And if we just come alongside them, it could be a time that changes their life. We also need to understand that as believers, we need to respond positively in all situations. We're in this together. Let's respond positively, not returning evil for evil, or reviling for reviling, but instead returning a blessing, knowing that this is what you were called. So what Peter tells us here is this is how we live in our faith community when our faith community maybe doesn't do what it's supposed to do. You know, sometimes when we look at the church, and usually when we're younger, we think everything's going to be good, and everything is going to work out in the right way, and in the end, everything is just going to be perfect, and we think maybe the church is going to be the same way, and we have the idea that the church is never going to fail. The church is always going to surround us with love. There's never going to be any conflict in the church, and my feelings will never get hurt, and I can just come here, and everything is always going to be good, and unfortunately, that's not the case. Even in church, you may get hurt. See, because unbelievers are going to sometimes act in ungodly ways. We're going to discover that there are people in our churches that are selfish and they're proud and they can be hurtful. And that happens. And you may be in church and you may even find that church leaders will behave in those ways. And there are times when there are people in your church that may let you down. And to be honest, there may be a time in our church that I might let you down. And it's at these times that we have to decide that how we're going to respond. Now, I remember my experience in this. I remember the first time that I was really hurt in a church. I remember being wounded and confused, and I remember thinking that maybe it was a time to give up and maybe even walk away, and it was a struggle. And it was then that I had to remember. It was then that I think, why am I doing this? It was then that it was a time of growth in my walk, my relationship with God, and it was a growth in my leadership and ministry. This passage says, look, bad things are going to happen. You need to learn how to respond. It tells us what not to do. Don't repay evil for evil. Don't get back. But it says, instead, return a blessing to evil. It says that this is your calling. We are called to do good even when nobody is doing good to us. And remember, Peter understands this. Peter's not just writing something because he wants to write something interesting. Peter is living this. He's living in a hostile world. He's living where he's had disagreements. Read through Acts. There are things that have happened. He's dealt with conflict. He's living in a world that's persecuted. He's living in a place where the church isn't relevant. It's not seen as relevant. And this is his response. And he says, to be like Christ. Look what Jesus did. As Jesus went, he was persecuted. As Jesus went through suffering. As Jesus died on the cross. Look at his response. And respond in the same way. You know, Jesus, forgive them. They do not know what they do. Jesus, who died for those very people. See, the goal is to be one who strengthens the fellowship and not one who tears it apart. And even when we're hurt, we have a goal to strengthen the fellowship together. And if we can do this, then we have the opportunity to truly seek righteousness. Let's read verses 10 through 12. For the one who desires life to love and see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. He must turn away from evil and do good. He must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous and his ears attend to the prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. And so in this section here, Peter's referring back to Psalm 34. And he gives this great advice. Look, you need to guard your tongue. Important for us to see the dangers of the tongue. James speaks to this in chapter 3, verses 9 and 10, where he says, by your tongue, with it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men. We've been made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth comes both blessings and cursings. My brothers, these things ought not to be this way. And so Peter says, look, if you're going to live in this faith community, if you're going to be a believer who lifts people up, you have to watch your tongue. The same tongue that gossips, the same tongue that curses, the same tongue that says hurtful things is the same tongue that we used a few minutes ago to sing praises to our God, and the same tongue that we use to encourage each other. And we have to guard the use of our tongue. Inconsistency in our tongue should not be that way. Seek righteousness and pursue God. See, we're reminded here of our motives. We need to have motives to do the right thing. And so what motivates us? It's our authority and our relationship with Jesus Christ. It's serving God. See, our motives are never about us. And if we can get the idea that this isn't about us, that it's about Him, it makes it so much easier to do these things because our motives are in the right place. We're pleasing God. We're not trying to please someone else. It's about who He is. See, we have a God who cares about you. We have a God who loves you and a God who wants what's best for you. And it takes so much pressure off if you're serving Him instead of trying to serve others. Serving God, we serve us because we love Him. Look, we live in this world and hostile things come. And the reality is that life is tough. And this is why it's so important that we have that focus and that desire to serve Him. See, then those who seek to do what was harm, they don't matter as much. It doesn't matter as much because they're not the ones who are important to us. See, in that church that I was wounded in that church that really came a crisis in my ministry, in that place, I had to come to a conclusion. Was I passionate about serving in that church or was I passionate about serving my God? And it was in that moment, in that time, that I discovered that my passion was in God and I had to do whatever I could to serve Him in whatever capacity He wanted me to. And honestly, if it wasn't for that moment, and if it wasn't for that moment of understanding that it was all about Him and nothing else, I probably wouldn't be standing here today. I don't know if I would have walked away from ministry if I would have understood that my passion had to be in who He was. And if we have that passion and we're pursuing Him, then we seek to give an answer for our faith. Let's look at verses 13 through 17 together. Who is there to harm you if you prove zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed. And do not fear their intimidation and do not be troubled, but sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts. Always be ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence, and keep a good conscience, so that the things in which you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ, will be put to shame. For it is better, if God should will it, that you suffer for doing what is right, rather than doing what is wrong. So consider here verse 13. You know, we're eager to do things that are good and things that are right. And it's, and if we do those things, and if we pursue things that are good, and we pursue things that are right, it is so much harder for people to criticize us. Now, it's not impossible. People will criticize you no matter what you do. But do what is right, and it takes away those arrows. See, when doing good becomes a driving force of our life, then the wrong things tend to go away. See, when you pursue God and you pursue doing things that are right and you're passionate about that, then maybe you're not so tempted to do the things that are wrong. And then it says, then if you suffer for what is doing right, then you are blessed. And then you don't have to fear the intimidation, and do not be troubled. And Peter wants us to understand that although doing right is not 100% protection against these things and against attack, that's what we're supposed to do. That we need to have this essence of goodness and the darkness to be plotted away from our life. And Jesus says, if you want to be my disciples, then you're going to take your cross and you're going to follow me. And Jesus says it's going to be hard. And he says that in this world you're going to have tribulation. But Jesus doesn't leave it there. He says, in this world you have tribulation. But he says, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. See, God brings blessing in his presence. And so we look at this idea of seeking to give an answer for our faith. See, we have an answer even in these difficult times. And we need to be passionate about honoring God. You know, we as Americans, we love our country. We are patriotic people. When the national anthem is played, when the Pledge of Allegiance is done, we stand and we salute our flag, take off our hats, everybody gets quiet. We are trained to do that. When the flag is raised or lowered, we'll stand at attention and we'll stand silently to do that. At our children's camp up in the mountain, every morning and every evening, they raise and lower the flag. And for those moments, you can hear a pin drop. Every kid is completely quiet as they honor the flag. How much more should we honor our Savior? How much more should we be focused without distractions on our God? See, American patriots, they don't want any dishonor to come to their flag, and they don't do anything to defend their flag. And Peter says, we need to come and give a defense of the gospel of Christ. Give a defense of the gospel. Have that passion for him. Verse 15 says, but sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, and always be ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence. See, the world can attack us for the things that we do, but the world, when they attack us for who we are, then they're attacking Christ. They attack us for what we believe, and they're attacking him. We have the opportunity to give a defense for what we believe. So many times we give a defense for things, and we like to argue things, and we hold on to our political positions rather tightly. And if somebody disagrees with us, we don't have any issue arguing our political position. We sometimes like to argue our current events, and if somebody has a different opinion of our current event, we don't mind letting people know what we think, and maybe not always, like it says here, with gentleness. We do these things, and then it comes to a place where we have the opportunity to give a defense for the gospel. Do we stand up for Christ? And share, you see, and I think what happens is so many times in our world that we do all the Christian things, and we do all the Christian ministry, and we do all the service, and then there comes a point where the world sees all this stuff, and we have to take the opportunity to share the hope of why we do it. So we don't do good stuff just because we love people, although we love people. We don't do good stuff just because we want to feed the poor, although we want to do that. We do stuff because we serve a God who brings death to life. This isn't just about making people's life better here. It's about eternity. And we need to be able to give an answer for the hope that's in us. Why do we do this? Because we believe, we truly believe that without a relationship with Jesus Christ, there is no hope. And we want people to know the hope. So that's what we do. We have this community together so we can encourage each other, but we have to give the hope of why we do this to the world. See, understand that we're going to struggle, and we're going to fail, and we're going to have a hard time with some of this. And as we look at this, sometimes we beat ourselves up, but Peter understands all of this. See, it was Peter who's writing this, is the same Peter that right after Jesus was arrested, that denied Jesus 3 times. This is the same Peter who says, give an account with gentleness. This was the same Peter that, when he was questioned, cursed out a little girl and said, I don't even know who Jesus is. Why do you keep bothering me? Not exactly gentleness. Peter understands the struggle. But the struggle doesn't give us an excuse not to do what God has called us to do. Because Peter grew in that. There are times as you read through Acts, you see Peter having these struggles as he establishes a church and the conflicts that happen inside the church and how Peter deals with those things and gives us a great example. And then he comes through and he writes this and says, this is how you are to live. And that is what we are challenged to you here this morning. To look at that example and live the way that he'd have us to do, a change that can only come from God. Are we willing to change? So this morning as our praise team comes and as we have our time of decision, our time of invitation, let me ask you this morning to consider your life. Not to consider the life of somebody around you, but to consider your life. And ask yourself the question, are you being the person that God would have you to be in the community of believers? Are you growing? Are you experiencing in these 5 areas that we talked about, these adjectives that describe a Christian's life? And be honest about the areas that maybe that we need some improvement as we struggle. And maybe this morning to think about really what you're most passionate about. And is it in pursuing him? And are you willing and able to give an account of your faith? Whatever God may be speaking to you here this morning, respond to him, listen to him, and do what God had you as we stand together and as we sing.
Desire,
together and worship together. As we close, let me remind you of a few announcements. This Wednesday evening, we're having our end of the school year church picnic. It'll be out at Weston Carey Events House. The address is in here. All you need to bring is a lawn chair. We'll provide all the food. We're going to celebrate our Wednesday night children's ministry, our SWAT program that evening. We are doing a baptism that evening as well, and so come participate in that with us. Great time. Be in prayer for Vacation Bible School. That information is in there. We'll be doing that on June 15th. Our annual Youth Missions Yard Sale information is in there. We'll start collecting stuff for that. Some people have been asking me if we're doing the yard sale. I have too much junk in my house to not do the yard sale, so we're doing that. Also, hunter safety classes are going to begin again. That information is in there. Had a conversation with Game and Fish, and they're going to start classes, so there's a June class. Our May class was canceled. We may do a July class as well to make up for that. Also, True Care Walk for Life. Like most organizations during this time, things have been a little tough, and this is one of the big fundraisers, and they're not doing it like normal. So notice that announcement if you can participate in that Walk for Life. And then so many other announcements. Also, was drawn to my attention in the earlier service that it says that next Sunday we're back to two services. That's not accurate. We're going to have three services one more week, and then the first Sunday in June is the scheduled time to try to go back to two services. And so, as always, those things may change. It's the world we live in. But the plan next week for right now is to do services one week like we have, and then make a transition the week after. So I want to draw your attention to that. And then as we leave, let's pray for each other. We need each other. We need each other's prayers. And so let's do that. And then continue praying for especially Caitlin Holland during this time as she deals with the cancer. And if you haven't picked up a prayer list from Wednesday nights, they're out there. Lots of needs, and let's be responsible to praying for each other. Tim, would you close us, please?
Oh, Lord Jesus Christ, we humbly come before you, thanking you for the opportunities you've given us, thanking you for all the blessings we've received. Lord, I just ask that during this weekend of a three-day weekend, we celebrate the lives that were given so we could have these freedoms. Lord, just remember those and the families that have lost their military personnel. We just ask that you would be with us, be with everybody here, that we would be glorifying you each and every day. We just ask these things in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen.